Hello, my dear friends. We all are here to prepare for different examinations, and specifically, we are doing MCQs on English literature. So, the same series we are going to continue in this video as well. So, till the time we prepare this, we will make other courses ready. If you require, you can contact us anytime. So, I hope you all are revising all the lessons one by one. Don't pile up your thing. Don't procrastinate, because if you procrastinate, then eventually you will have lots and lots of tasks to complete. Therefore, start completing the same from now itself. Okay? So we will move ahead with today's video, which is from different topics. Let's begin. Question number one. Hamlet's question, to be or not to be, means option A, to kill Claudius or not to kill him. Option B, to kill Gertrude or not to kill her. Option C, to marry Ophelia or not to marry her. Or option D, to live or to die. So correct answer is option D, that is to live or to die. Here it's not about Claudius, who is uncle of Prince Hamlet. It's not also about Gertrude, his mother, and not even about Ophelia, girlfriend of Prince Hamlet. It's about he himself, whether to live or to die. To be or not to be is the opening phrase of a soliloquy uttered by Prince Hamlet. Soliloquy means to talk with oneself in this stage. Okay, this soliloquy will be heard by the audience, but not by any other character in the play who are performing the play. Alright? Shakespeare's play Hamlet, it is in Act 3, Scene 1. Let's move to question number 2. Which of the following sentences has the figure of speech called apostrophe? Here, option A is man is the measure of all things. Option B, patriotism. What horrors are done in your name? Option C, my love is a red rose. Option D, all that glitters is not gold. So here option B is correct, that is, patriotism is being given human attribute. It is referred as if it's a human being. Patriotism, that horrors, what horrors are done in your name? So it is apostrophe. Highlighter says, as a literary device, apostrophe refers to a speech or address to a person who is not present or to a personified object, such as Yorick's skull is Hamlet. Yorick's skull in Hamlet. It comes from the Greek word apostrophein, which means to turn away. Question number 3. Which of the following words is onomatopoeic? Option A, carry. Option B, fear. Option C, beer. Option D, bug. So here, option D is correct. Bug is an onomatopoeic word. Onomatopoeia is when a word describes a sound and actually mimics the sound of the object or action it refers to when it is spoken. Question number 4. The statement, namely, happiness is but an occasional episode in the general drama of the pain, contains the figure of speech called option A, simile, option B, personification, option C, paradox, option D, metaphor. Here it is metaphor. There is comparison. Let's see the highlighters. A metaphor is a figure of speech that describes an object or action in a way that isn't literally true but helps explain an idea or make a comparison. A metaphor states that one thing is another thing. It equates these two things not because they actually are the same, but for the sake of comparison or symbolism. Question number 5. When the sound of a word resembles the sound it denotes, the figure of speech is option A, synecdoche. Option B, onomatopoeia. Option B, prosopopeia.
Option D, transferred epithet. Here, option B is correct, that is onomatopoeia. Let's see the highlighters. Onomatopoeia is when a word describes a sound and actually mimics the sound of the object or action it refers to when it is spoken. Question number 6. The repetition of vowel sound in a sequence of nearby words is called option A, rhyme, option B, rhythm, option C, assonance, and option D, caesura. Here it is option A, C, that is assonance. Assonance or vowel rhyme is the repetition of vowel sounds across a line or text or poetry. The words have to be near enough to each other that the similar vowel sounds are noticeable. Let's move to question number 7. What is the name of an implied simile? It is metaphor. Option A, is it? Option B, apostrophe? Option C, hyperbole? Or option D, none of the above? So it is option A, metaphor. Implied simile is metaphor. A metaphor is a figure of a speech that describes an object or action in a way that isn't literally true but helps explain an idea or make a comparison. A metaphor states that one thing is another thing. It equates these two things not because they actually are the same but for the sake of comparison or symbolism. Question number 8. What is a direct address to the dead, to the absent, or to the personified object or idea? Option A, epigram. Option B, personification. Option C, apostrophe. Or option D, none of the above. So it is apostrophe. It is also called apostroph. Okay. As a literary device, apostroph refers to a speech or address to a person who is not present or to a personified object, such as Yorick's skull in Hamlet. It comes from the Greek word apostrophion, which means to return away, to turn away. Question number 9. What is the figure of a speech when the real meaning is exactly the opposite of that which is expressed by word apparently? Option A, satire. Option B, irony. Option C, oxymoron. And option D, none of the above. So it is option B, that is irony. The definition of irony as literary device is a situation in which there is a contrast between expectation and reality. Let's move to question number 10. What figure of speech has been used in the following line? Option A, all the perfumes of Arabia cannot sweeten this little hand. Option A, metaphor. Option B, oxymoron. Option C, hyperbole. And option D, apostrophe or apostrophe. It is option C, hyperbole, exaggeration. Hyperbole is the use of exaggeration as a rhetorical device or figure of speech. Hyperbole, from a Greek word meaning excess, is a figure of speech that uses extreme exaggeration to make a point or show emphasis. Question number 11. The movement of return to nature has to do with which age? The neoclassical age, the romantic age, the restoration age, or none of these? So here option B is correct, that is the romantic age. Romanticism was an artistic, literary, musical, and intellectual movement that originated in Europe towards the end of 18th century and is most areas was at its peak in the approximate period from 1800 to 1850. The Romantic movement in English poetry is generally described as a return to nature. But nature for the Romantics were completely different from the notion held by Augustine or neoclassical authors. Question number 12. What played the most important part in shaping Ernest Hemingway's literary creation, like Farewell to Arms? Option A, experience of war. Option B, his friends and relations. Option C, his love affair and marriages. Option D, his power of oratory. It is option A, that is experiences of war, which played the most important part in shaping Ernest Hemingway's literary creations like Farewell to Arms. A Farewell to Arms is a novel by Ernest Hemingway set during the Italian campaign of First World War. First published in 1929, it is a first-person account of an American, Frederick Henry, serving as a lieutenant in the ambulance corps of the Italian army. The title is taken from a poem by the 16th century English dramatist George Paley. Question number 13, which one of the following poet wrote the poem entitled Dover Beach? Dover Beach is written by Arnold. Option A, is it option B, Tennyson, option C, Milton, and option D, Wordsworth? So it is written by Matthew Arnold. Let's see the highlighters. Matthew Arnold was an English poet and cultural critic who worked as an inspector of schools. He was the son of Thomas Arnold, the celebrated headmaster of Rugby School. He was born on 24th December 1822 at Laleham, Middlesex, England. He died on 15th April 1888 at the age of 65 in Liverpool, England. Question number 14. The imaginary county Yoknapatawpha occurs in the novel of option A, Hardy, option B, Dickens, option B, Faulkner, option D, Mulk Raj Anand. So your correct answer out here is Faulkner. In his work, in his novel, we find this county, this place, Yoknapatawpha. William Cuthbert Faulkner was an American writer and Nobel Prize laureate from Oxford, Mississippi. Faulkner wrote novels, short stories, screenplays, poetries, essays, and a play. He is primarily known for his novels and short stories set in the fictional Yoknapatawpha County, based on Lafayette County, Mississippi, where he spent most of his life. Question number 15. The Wasteland was published in the year 1915, option A, 1918, option B, 1920, option C, and option D, 1922. So here correct option is option D, 1922. In the year 1922, The Wasteland, which is written by T.S. Eliot, was published. Highlighter says, The Wasteland is a poem by T.S. Eliot, widely regarded as one of the most important poems of the 20th century and a central work of modernist poetry. It was published in 1922. It has 334 lines. Poem first appeared in the United Kingdom in the October issue of Eliot's The Criterion and in the United States in the November issue of The Dial. It was published in book form in December 1922. It's not from, it's form, okay? In book form in December 1922. Question number 16. The phrase willing suspension of disbelief is associated with option A, Byron, option B, Keats, option C, Coleridge, and option D, Wordsworth. So, the phrase willing suspension of disbelief is concerned or associated with Coleridge, S.T. Coleridge. Samuel Taylor Coleridge, well known as S.T. Coleridge, was an English poet, literary critic, philosopher, and theologian who, with his friend William Wordsworth,
was a founder of the Romantic movement in England and a member of Lake Poets. He also shared volumes and collaborated with Charles Lamb, Robert Southey and Charles Lyod. Question number 17. The sonnet, "The World Is Too Much With Us," is written by option A, Scott, option B, Keats, option C, Shelley, and option D, William Wordsworth. So here it is William Wordsworth. The sonnet, "The World Is Too Much With Us," is written by William Wordsworth. William Wordsworth was an English romantic poet who, with S.T. Coleridge, helped to launch the Romantic Age in English literature with their joint publication of Lyrical Ballads. Question number 18. Who called Shelley a beautiful but an ineffectual angel beating in the void his luminous wings in vain? Option A, John Ruskin. Option B, Matthew Arnold. Option C, T.S. Eliot. And option D, Tennyson. So here it is Matthew Arnold who called Shelley a beautiful but an ineffectual angel beating in the void his luminous wings in vain. Matthew Arnold was an English poet and cultural critic who worked as an inspector of schools. He was the son of Thomas Arnold, the celebrated headmaster of Rugby School. He was born on 24th December 1822 in Laleham, Middlesex, England, and he died on 15th April 1888 at the age of 65 in Liverpool, England. Question number 19. Adonias by Shelley is an elegy on option A, Wordsworth, option B, Byron, option C, Keats, option D, Coleridge. So it is John Keats, on whom Shelley had written Adonias. John Keats was an English romantic poet. He was one of the main figures of the second generation romantic poets, along with John Lord Byron and Percy Bysshe Shelley, despite his works having been in publication for only 4 years before his death from tuberculosis at the age of 25. Question number 20. Who asserted himself as a classicist in literature, royalist in politics, and Anglo-Catholic in religion? Option A, Matthew Arnold. Option B, T.S. Eliot. Option C, Walt Whitman. And option D, none of these. So here correct answer is T.S. Eliot. T.S. Eliot asserted himself as a classicist in literature, royalist in politics, and Anglo-Catholic in religion. Let's see the highlighters. Thomas Stearns Eliot was an American-born British poet, essayist, publisher, playwright, literary critic, and editor. He was born on 26 September 1888 at St. Louis, Missouri, United States. He died on 4th January 1965 in Kensington. Friends, by this we have completed day 21's MCQs, and here we had discussed different writers' MCQs. I hope it was helpful for you all. Do let me know whether these videos are helping you all or not. We will meet soon with some other video. Till then we meet. Take care and study well. If you require anything, do drop message here in the contact number which is given or email ID which is provided here. We will be happy to help you all. Your success is our motive. So take care and all the best everyone.